excites it about is also the digitization of agriculture. Because I see this country, so many things happen in fintech. Amazing. The unicorns are coming. But the really interesting thing is when the entire economy digitalizes. When you have machinery that will give you the data, when you have the satellite connection that will, you know, give you a better idea what to do. So that hinterland connection, that connectivity, and as you say, to bridge the digital divide, which is a high risk new social divide, that is the point. So I don't think that skills can go without connectivity. And digitization of businesses, of course, the three come together. The fourth part for us is digitization of public administration for ease of doing business, for
data transparency,
for everything that comes with a trusted public administration that is there to serve people's needs, to serve the need of businesses. So these four things is what we are pushing. What do they say to you, these young people? What are the barriers that they are faced with? And where do they go after you?
You know, so the yearnings, the barriers. First is they talk about access to capital. Mm-hmm. And we have also seen from our close interaction with them, from our monitoring and evaluation, that they need business education. They need to be trained. So they know how to even manage capital. What we give to them is a non-refundable cash of $5,000. But we have seen that they need to know how to manage resources. So we train them. And we also, they tell us and we observe that they need mentors. You know, we need people to handhold them. We need people they can call up 1 a.m. or 10 a.m. and say, these are happy problems. How do you think I should handle it? So we'll do that. They need, like you said, the ease of doing business. They need the right environment to do business. In fact, once I was invited for this part of one's public advocacy to give a talk on tax administration in Nigeria. And I put out on Twitter, and you know, I said, guys, I'm going to engage the government. What are your, you amazed that all the response I got, over 60% of them talked about tax and tax, double taxation, so many multiple taxation issues. And so I took this and I addressed it when I met with the policy maker. Interestingly, they've improved on that. But that's Nigeria, for me to see that across Africa. For women, in some of the jury, they tell us about tightening process, land tightening, planning process. It's tackling. In fact, in some areas, in Africa, in the 21st century, women are not allowed to own plots of land. So it's also an advocacy that one is, you know, engaging government to say, come on, why can't women? I think a country I just passed it, they say, Senegal or Cote d'Ivoire, one of the two now that women can now own properties. So these are some of the challenges now. So, policy issues, capital, assets of capital, and then capacitizing the entrepreneur to succeed. From what we also see, because our intervention is non-refundable seed capital, we've seen that some of them have grown and they need 2.0, so to speak, they need like next phase. And so we're also trying to see partner institutions, agencies that can help provide capacity for that capacity support to enable them move to the next level. A few of them, you know, AFD in France, you know, we have an arrangement with them to help support some. United Farm for Africa is also helping some of them. So that is one of the areas where they need support. The biggest challenge that African younger entrepreneurs have is access to electricity. Access to election. All these ideas, a lot can happen if we had improvement in access to electricity. that is a challenge. And so, you know, it's a major issue. We've tried and are on to see what we can do, but just like a drop, tiny drop in the ocean. We have an interest in the electric generation, but we do just about, we have capacity of 2,000 megawatts, but it's nothing. The way we produce that because of some of our constraints is nothing compared to what we need on the continent to power industrialization, to drive the FTG, to have so many things to work. So access to this is my deep of action, you know, but it will still on that one come from next to that. But once I wrote, I think it's the economy of somewhere, I prepared for a Marshall Plan for the development of Africa, and I said access to electricity should be one single most critical lens for all of us should qualify to see how we can make a difference, even of this access digitization, just only to some extent, you know, with that electricity. Yes. So it's that Iroquois thing that if we were able to do and catalyze in a manner that we cannot even quantify or even imagine, development across the world.
And one would think that with the lack of electricity to start from there, it would be possible to go directly to renewable electricity so that one oversteps all these steps that the rest of us are trying to get more independence from these days, because they are such a threat. And what is the progress of that? Because someone told me that 700 million inhabitants on the African continent have no access to electricity.
Oh, no, it's true. In fact, 1.2 million per billion people,
yes,
about 30% have access to electricity. In fact, when you even talk about reliable electricity, it's also another problem entirely. It's a major issue. And for me, again, some ongoing conversation, I think where Africa is at this point in time in terms of electricity deficit, we need a combination of options together. Combination thermal electricity, hydroelectricity, renewable, you know, a kind of combination, you know, to like consistently for like next 5 years. At least we all have this commitment to carbon emission net zero by say 2050, next 5 years, we need to do something because it's getting more difficult. If I expect, take Nigeria for instance. In 2012-15, we're talking about 5,000 to 6,000 megawatts of electricity, a country of 200 million plus people. Today, it's like 4,000.
Yes.
So, where do you expect to move in this direction? Too many bottlenecks and constraints, yes, not moving. And then this is a country with huge demography.
Yeah.
Want to do something about this.
Yeah.
And so, and that is why, again, I like, and, you know, so in the past, until we started dealing with your core, I didn't know the sheer amount of your intervention in Africa.
Mm.
You know, it's huge. But when I start seeing the figures, I'm like, wow. It's, you know, it's like your heroes are there, are not even recognized, so to speak, but there's so much happening. And I want to say thanks to the 27 countries that are behind this, and to you, your colleagues, for making this, even pushing for the attention of your political leaders to understand the real need of the world continent. President Macron was our guest, I think about three years ago. And so what I did was to invite younger entrepreneurs from 20 countries. But like, next time you're coming, we need to put someone else to my product and have them ask you at the question, then they will tell you directly, because you guys are doing great things. Especially like this, women, people supported, they need to know where they're coming from. And so we put President Macron, you know, this arrangement. They've interacted, and most of them, again, it's all about, if one of them said, no, Mr. President, we're energetic, we're intelligent, we can become the future CEO of the right to do that. It's a major issue, and major issue. So thanks for also helping to engage our political leaders to understand the importance of this. We need concerted effort to make this happen. Thank you.
That talent, all that drive to be fully integrated in the Nigerian, but also in the African economy. Nigeria, obviously, as such an important player, has a huge role also on the continent regionally. So it's important for me to understand how do you see this?
Your Excellency, you and your team, your organization, you've been doing a lot for Africa, and we appreciate it. I'll let the Pacific and other parts of the world appreciate what you do for all of us, but for us in Africa, we do appreciate this. Only just last year, your agency supported the work of the Tony Elumelu Foundation with $25 million. That is significant, that is huge. And with that, we're able to scale the impact and the support for the young African entrepreneurs. You know, you said something, you said something about neighbor, your next door neighbor. You see Africa as your next door neighbor. Indeed, that is what it is, especially in today's global world. When I see people die trying to cross the Mediterranean, you know, my heart bleeds, and I say to myself, what can we do to stop this? And the demonstration of what we can do to stop this, what you, and did through the support for young African entrepreneurs. Through your help and support, we were able to scale up support for women entrepreneurs in Africa through the EU. Today, we have 70% of the beneficiaries for 2020-21 are females, over 70% of 5,000 people, over 300,000. This would not have been possible by us. This is why I feel not the impetus, the encouragement to go back more aggressively than to advertise for more people to apply for the current thing, knowing that all things being equal, we'll be able to capacitize and support more. When you support women, as you know, women entrepreneurs, is support the immediate beneficiaries. It's support for their communities, for their families, and for the country. Especially in the part of the world where women have been educated for so long. So, you know, I speak as someone who is surrounded by women. I have five daughters, I call my wife, my mother, and two sisters. And in my workplace, you know, we have a lot of female leadership. And so I know what it means to support women. And that is one of the things your organization has helped us to advance for. And I want to say thank you. I never thank you guys enough for that. The second passion that we share is youth empowerment. And I see, again, a connection between what you guys believe in and what we do. And youth, men, women. You know, the reason we have these people trying to go through difficult and harsh conditions to get to Europe is because they're in search of better living. And they say to themselves, I'd rather die in the Mediterranean, try to cross, than suffer where we are. And so it is hopelessness that leads people to that extremism. Also, extremism is security or security issue. Our young ones, talented people, are now misguided and applying their talent in the wrong way. And that's why we have it. And we can see what's happening in the Sahel region of Africa and northern part of Nigeria. So when you support young African entrepreneurs, you support beyond again them as the primary beneficiaries, is addressing the migration issue, is helping to create eliminate poverty, is helping to create economic growth to them, for them, is helping to reduce security challenges around the continent. And I like the fact also that your digitization in the 21st century. You know, if we want to create a sustainable and equitable world, we must make sure that everyone has access to internet and connectivity. I see my young boys at home, and they know a lot more than I knew, of course, even as an adult, because they have access to iPad, they have access to internet calling. And I ask myself, how would the future, I can't even imagine the future with them and their calling friends who don't have such access. And so we're not helping these children. We're creating more problems for them, because the extremism and insecurity we see today will be a child's play compared to what's in the future. And in Africa, most of our people reside in rural areas. And so what you are committed to in this area of digitalization and engaging with our policymakers to realize that that's the future is wonderful. And we appreciate it and look forward to how we can collaborate further to make this work. In my public advocacy, beyond what we do at the foundation, I try to let our leaders know that the future of these young ones, our continent in the hands of these young ones. And if we don't look after them well, we create bigger problems for ourselves. At the Tony Elumelu Foundation, which we founded in 2010, is not from the place of abundance, too much money. No, it's not. But it's just that looking introspectively in our own journey and who we are or have become, we realize that there's some element of luck, which is being adaptable, right? And then asking yourself, what would you, are you doing to support others so that they too don't die with their ideas, so that they too have economic hope and opportunity, so they too can see the better side of life. And realizing that development is nothing if you don't develop the individual. So to us, I see EU. I'm very passionate about your organization, because to support this kind of initiative is the kind of thing we've been, some of us have been clamoring for, that in the 21st century, we should give from the point of view of helping people to become self-reliant, self-independent, with their dignity, and that we should partner with people on ground that understand the true needs of the people. And that is what you guys have demonstrated. So going forward, I want to see greater collaboration between your organization, Dr. Baba, and our organization in the area of economic empowerment for our young ones, in the area of economic opportunity for our females, in the area of digitization, poverty alleviation, and job creation. So I look forward to greater collaboration through people,